As Pastor Scott mentioned, my name is Joe Bragg, and I am definitely honored to be here with you this morning. I was able to make it out from Kalamazoo. Roads were good, which was awesome, huge blessing. But as was mentioned as well, that I am with Kalamazoo Youth for Christ. I've been there for a little over 3 years now. I've had the awesome privilege of being the ministry director there. And long and short, I oversee all the ministry operations that are happening in Kalamazoo County. It's a big operation. It's been a lot of fun, a lot of learning and growing for sure. But it is an absolute blessing to be able to bring the good news of Jesus to young people. In particular, I work with a lot of urban youth, and so we're in the city of Kalamazoo, and we just recently opened a rec center on the east side. And we're seeing an average of about 35 to 40 students a night when we're open, and we're able to share the gospel with them. We're walking alongside them. We're getting them into mentor programs with other like-minded Christian individuals that are able to pour into these young people. And we're also in schools, actually, your very own Pastor Scott over here. I'm going to keep calling him Pastor Scott because I know how much he loves it, is in Plainwell Middle School in one of our Campus Life programs and is able to work with David Zeiderveen to share the gospel with young people here in Plainwell. And it's just a real blessing. And so we really take our responsibility serious, and we want to bring glory and honor to Jesus as well as be able to just pour into these young people in a holistic way. We meet them right where they're at, right? We're going to minister to them as many ways as we can. If that means they need clothing or food, we want to meet them there. But most importantly, we want them to see the love of Christ in and through us. And so, again, it's an absolute joy. I take my role very seriously, because I see the weight of it and the need for Christ. Obviously, I think we all would sit here and say, yeah, I need Jesus every second of every day. But these young people have never been in a church. Most of them have never opened a Bible. So it's all brand new. And so to be able to sit down and really talk to them about the only hope that we have in Jesus is a real blessing. And it's amazing. We've just seen since we opened, we've seen a little over 22 kids actually put their faith in Christ, say yes to Jesus, and then start what we would kind of call like a discipleship process. And it's just been a real blessing, really amazing, eye-opening experience to just watch a kid hear the gospel for the first time and say, I want that. My life is a mess, but there seems to be hope. And so it's just incredible, and enough about that this morning, but I do want to encourage you that God is in the business of transforming lives, and he is moving through our area, which is just a beautiful thing to see. And we do have a lot to cover this morning, and we're actually going to be talking about discipleship, so I hope that's okay. Is everyone all right with that? Okay, a couple of you are good. The rest of y'all are just going to have to deal with it because you're here, right? All right, cool. Awesome. I don't know about you, but I am incredibly thankful for this clicker that I completely forgot that I'm responsible for. Which button is it, George? This is going to be a mess. We'll see what happens here. Cool. But yeah, so again, I am very thankful for the people that have poured into my life. The people that have taken the time and taken my discipleship seriously, that they have given themselves in such a way that they have come alongside me during trial, during non-trials, right? During the good times and the bad times. And they've walked alongside me. And these individuals are exponentially instrumental in my growth. And your pastor, Pastor George, has been one of those people. I came to Christ in 2008, actually February 17th of 2008, and George was one of the first people that I really connected with, and he took my walk and my growth in Jesus seriously and came alongside me, and so I'm very thankful for your pastor. But I didn't grow up in church, okay? I didn't grow up in church, and I didn't come to Christ until I was 27. But after coming to know Jesus, I was very hungry to learn. Right, I wanted to dig in, and these individuals that came alongside me, they spent countless hours walking with me. They leaned into my life, and actually all of them continue to do so to this day, which is a huge blessing for me. I'm the product of people taking the time. people who love Jesus poured into my life in a holistic way. And we've had many hard conversations along the way, but I'm all the better for it. I hope you can sit here today and say that there are people in your life that have taken the time. And I also hope that you're one of those people that take the time in someone else's life. No, not that button. Yeah, it's cool. Whatever. All right, bam. All right, perfect. That works. Dietrich Bonhoeffer once stated one of the more profound truths as it relates to following Christ. And he said that salvation is free, but discipleship will cost you your life. Now, in order to be a disciple, one must find themselves under the authority of Christ, fully surrendered to him as Lord of our lives. And if we're surrendered to Jesus in this way, then we know the call that he has placed on our lives. And this morning we'll be looking at that call, and then we'll be discussing Jesus' words to his disciples before he ascended to the right hand of the Father. But sadly, I think we take something like discipleship as well as evangelism, and we sort of put them in this box. We create almost like a formulaic checklist so that we can look at the checklist and say, I'm doing a good job. I've checked these boxes this week, and therefore, I'm doing the right things. I'm good, right? Prime example, I don't know if any of y'all are on Facebook, but this is what I see a lot of times is I made my Bible posts for the day, or I posted some cute quote, or I said, hey, you need to know Jesus on Facebook, and I leave it at that, and I check my box and say, I have done my evangelistic duty. I've edified the church by my Facebook post. I'm good. And that's sort of where it stops. We can all do this. We can fall into this trap. Sometimes we might even feel guilty and say, oh, I haven't posted a Bible verse, or I haven't maybe just said praying for you to somebody, or I didn't go to the store and just say Jesus loves you, or I haven't done those things in a while, and so therefore I should probably go do one of them. And then we go and we do one little thing, and then we're like, okay, cool, I'm back on track and I'm good to go. And we have a tendency to create this list because we want to gauge ourselves against it and say, all right, I've done a good job. And we isolate this, and we put this in this box, we have this checklist. But the question that I have for you this morning is, are you pouring into the lives of others? Are you pouring in to someone else's life? And it can be simple, but are you doing it? Are you pouring into other people? Are we making our time with God a priority, and are we making people a priority? And you're going to hear maybe some hard things today. I promise you I'm not here to beat you over the head. I preach to myself first. That's one of the things you just don't see coming when you're preaching, is you realize that as you start to work through a message, you start to pray, you start to get in God's word, that he really starts working on your heart. And then I'm just talking out loud and I'm really hearing it. But are you pouring into people's lives? Or have you found yourself complacent? This is a powerful question. Because again, it's my desire to see the body of Christ function as we are to function, right? And I do believe that that starts, is the result of a desire that we have. And for myself personally, it starts with me being an example. So I can't sit here and tell you, hey, you need to pour into someone else if I am not pouring into other people. And I take that very seriously. But I want to sum up discipleship and evangelism in one phrase, and I think it works very well for both of these functions, and it's not as complicated as you think. It can actually be quite fun, and it can bring a lot of joy. And that one phrase is this: do life together. That's it. Do life together. That sums up discipleship and evangelism very well. Your mission statement is always grow in what? In love for God and in love for people, right? Always grow in love for God and in love for people. So I'm going to do that by spending time with God and spending time with people, right? That's what it is. That's what it's on your bulletin. This is that simple. Do life together. It can be a blast. It destroys the checklist. It just says, hey, I want to grow in my relationship with God, and I want to grow in my relationship with people. I just want to do life with them. I want to pour into other people's lives because people have taken the time to pour into my life, and because of the love that God has for me, right, that has sparked this love that I have for him, and in turn, I love others. There are actually 59 one another exhortations in the New Testament, and you would know an exhortation is a strong and emphatic urging, and all of these exhortations tell us how to treat one another, how we're to do life with one another, the things that we are not to do with or towards one another, right? They're very specific. Don't do this, but do this. Love one another. Take care of one another. This is consistently all over the Bible. That we are to do life together as brothers and sisters in Christ, and that this has an impact in our lives as followers of Jesus and has an impact in our community as other people see the love that we have for God and for one another, and they will know that we are his disciples, right? And then Matthew 5, we would see the fact that we would live in such a way that our light shine, not so that we get the glory, but that God get the glory, right? This is what happens when we do life together. We grow, and the people around us see it, and we hopefully have the opportunity to preach the gospel. This is not complicated. We overcomplicate it. Or we find ourselves complacent because we fear rejection or that we're not smart enough. Well, I can't disciple somebody because I don't know enough. Well, there's a simple solution to that. Start learning, right? Start studying. Things you don't know, maybe you get in. And if someone asks you a question that you don't know, guess what? Simply tell them, I don't know. But then take it a step further and say, I'm going to find out. Or let's find out together. And then just answer that. What you're showing them is that I care enough about you to take the time to learn something I don't know so that we can grow together. That's beautiful. But when we're looking at discipleship, I think Jesus summed this up very well in Luke 9. 23 through 24, and if I can get this thing to work here, one of these buttons. Oh, all right, cool. I'll let you take that. Whatever. He says this: if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. I want to break it down just a little bit, and then we're going to unpack, all right? So the phrase, come after me, in this instance here, means to become a disciple. And this is made very clear in Luke 14, 27, when Jesus says, whoever does not carry his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. So Jesus is saying, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. And he really brings it home in Luke 14, whoever does not carry his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. And as a disciple of Jesus, it requires that we first deny ourselves. This is not simply a matter of denying certain things, right? I'm not going to eat this ice cream, and I'm a good disciple of Jesus because I didn't eat the ice cream. Right? That's not what we're talking about here. This is more particularly about denying personal control over one's life. Specifically, denying yourself is denying personal control over one's life, fully surrendered to Jesus. Second, we must take up our cross. This one is intense, right? But it means that we are going to make a commitment to Jesus that may lead to rejection and possibly even death. Right? Like when they hear take up your cross, the disciples at that time weren't fully understanding what's going on. On this side, and I'm sure they saw it when they saw Jesus carrying his cross, right? But not in this conversation. But as he's carrying his cross, they start to think, wait, he told us we had to carry ours. Jesus rejected, Jesus put to death. And Jesus is telling his disciples that you need to carry your cross, that you need to follow me, you need to follow my example, and that doing so may lead to rejection and possibly a physical death. Jesus himself says that we will be hated by all because of his name. I don't think he's saying this just to be cute. I think he's saying, like, hey, people aren't going to like it. You're going to talk about me, and they're not going to be okay with it. You're going to be rejected. They may persecute you. Brothers and sisters in this world right now are being put to death simply for proclaiming the name of Jesus. They're being thrown in prison or beaten. That's carrying our cross. That's making a commitment that no matter what, I am following Jesus, even if I may get rejected or even if I may face physical death. But Jesus, in his language here of denying ourselves, is speaking of a physical death in a way when he's saying, you need to release control of your life. You need to give it to me. You need to surrender your life to me and be about the things that I am about. And then Jesus, again, says, follow me. And that's simply put, we follow Jesus. We get about following the examples and teaching of Jesus. And in Jesus' day, when he says this, follow me essentially meant join my crew, right? Come and do what I'm doing. Like, literally, leave your stuff and follow me. The implications are still the same here for us. When we follow Jesus, we are leaving behind our old way of life. We are getting about his way of life and following after him in his examples and teaching. Literally, we would see this throughout the New Testament, that the old self has died, right? And that we are made new. We are a new creation in Christ. Therefore, I am leaving the old way. I'm getting about Christ's way. And I'm following him. This is, or can be, a pretty intense statement within itself. Because so often we want to hold on to our old self. We want to hold on to these old things. We don't want to let them go. But Jesus is like, look, you got to let them go, right? When he's calling his disciples, a couple of them, right, got out of the boat, left dad, and left their livelihood and went and followed Jesus. They left everything behind. This is what we're looking at here. There's really no sugarcoating this. These are the realities that are set before us in God's word. And as a result, I praise him for three things. His word, his spirit, and his people. It is by God's word and the power of the Holy Spirit that we are transformed from the inside out. And we are to do life together, holding each other accountable to the things of God and bearing one another's burdens. You and I cannot do this alone. We can't. I don't know about you. I've tried. Failed. I had to come to the conclusion, Joe, you can't do this on your own. You can't. You need to be in my word. You need to trust me, and I've given you the Spirit of God dwells inside of you, and you gotta be open and involved with my people. Because you can't do it alone. Though the call is intense, though the things Jesus is saying are very real and very hard for us sometimes to swallow, he has given us everything we need to be able to walk in the calling. He has not left us with nothing. He's given us everything in his word, his spirit, and his people. I praise God for that. Try this again. What? No, you can actually go to the first point. Sorry, I'm hard to follow. I'm fast. There you go. Perfect. This is very important for us to understand this morning, is that discipleship isn't simply transferring information. Rather, it teaches obedience through obedience. Okay, I'm going to say it again. Discipleship isn't simply transferring information. Rather, it teaches obedience through obedience. I know a lot of times, again, we reduce discipleship just to this transferring of information, but this is so much more. It's teaching obedience through obedience. And I want to use the example of a rabbi for a second. All right? Rabbis have disciples, and these disciples seek to model their life after their rabbis. And they go to great lengths to know about their rabbi's life. They seek to follow their example to the T. I mean, it gets intense. They're clinging to the rabbi. They are, every word they say, they are taking a note. They are getting everything down, and then they're just watching their life. And they're analyzing it, and they want every part of that rabbi's life to become a part of theirs. So everything the rabbi says or does is important to them, and then they look to graft it into their lives. And so to be a disciple of a rabbi, you are chosen by the rabbi. It's a great honor, and one that the disciple that's chosen takes very seriously. So proximity is very important when we're looking at discipleship. See, Jesus did life with the 12, right? They went everywhere with him. They studied him. They listened to him. They had opportunities to go and imitate him. And Jesus taught a very profound yet simple method of discipleship. That's I do, we do, you do. This is Jesus' methodology. I'm going to do it. Watch me. Then we're going to do it together. Now you go out and do it. But this method requires community. It requires community. And something that we really need to understand here and need to make no mistake is that we are all being discipled by something or someone. And we are either being discipled by God or you're being discipled by the world. And what you put in is what you will put out. Right, so if we're constantly digesting the things of the world and neglecting our walk with God, you're going to begin to look more like the world than you are Jesus. Can we agree on this? That what I'm putting in is what I'm going to begin to put out. This makes sense, right? I'm a relatively pudgy guy. It's not because I eat vegetables all the time. What I put in, I'm going to put out. Right? Just keeping it simple, plain. What I'm digesting is what I am going to essentially regurgitate. That's kind of gross. We'll stop there. It is important for us to be constantly examining our lives and asking hard questions according to the Word of God. It's vital. It's not just intended to be some thing we do, but it's intended to be who we are. To spend time with our Father. To be in His Word. To be in prayer. To be with His people. Then we start to look like Jesus, who is our teacher. We are His disciples. We are to cling to Him. We are to look at His example. Right? And we're to look at His example in our brothers and sisters in Christ. And I say, man, that person loves Jesus. Like I said, Pastor George, man, when I came to Christ, I saw a dude that loved Jesus and I learned from him. Right? We sat down, we did life together. We still do, just a little less frequent than we maybe want to. But that's somebody who came in and I was like, hey, you're following Jesus. You love Christ. We're about the same age. He's way older than I am, but... Not true. But you know, this is somebody who I can relate to, who loves Christ. I want to talk to that dude. Hey, what books can you recommend me? Or what do you do in this situation? Et cetera, et cetera. But it required community, right? It required George and I sitting down and having hard conversations about stuff and digging in. And you know George's love for the education that he gets in his teaching, right? So for me, I'm like, this is sweet. I got a guy who loves to learn, who loves to teach. Awesome. I'm a sponge. Let's go. Right? Like that matters to me. I'm trying not to cry. I'm like getting there, man. But I'm trying not to. There's a lot of dust in the room. My fault. But again, it challenges me to examine my life. But if I don't have proximity, I don't have people in my life, guess what I don't have to do? Examine it. Because no one knows, no one sees. That was one of the unforeseen blessings and challenges of marriage. Now all of a sudden I'm in a proximity with somebody and I'm like, oh man, I have a lot of things I have to deal with. Woof. Right? Now I have someone super close to me that we're walking this thing out together and it's like, man, I didn't realize I had some of these things that I hadn't dealt with. And instead of being like, no, I think that's beautiful. And that my wife challenges me to grow consistently. And I think that's awesome. Proximity and community are so important so that we can find ourselves digesting the things of God and imitating Christ in a very dark and lost world. Something that is also important to understand, I'm going to try to tie this together, which would be the next point, is that discipleship is worship. Discipleship is worship. I'm going to read a section here from Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, which you're probably very familiar with. But I just want to read this here, and I want us to sit in it for a second, and then we'll tie it all together. But it says, therefore, I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice, acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may prove what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. As people, we don't tend to love the word obedience. We're not a big fan of the word obedience. It tends to well up a resistance deep within us. But Paul's making something clear here, that our obedience to God is worship. As we present our bodies as a living and holy sacrifice, that our obedience to Christ is worship, is adoration. Jesus sums it up this way, very simply. If you love me, you will what? Keep my commandments. That our adoration, that our love, that our worship is displayed in our obedience to God. And again, to remove any legalistic bend, this isn't have to, this is get to. I get to obey God. This is huge, right? I don't have to, I get to, because I love him and I want to reflect that love by what? Obeying him. Because if I love him, I will obey him. Not because I have to, but because I get to, because he has given me new life in Christ. And now as a result, I can choose righteousness. I can choose Christ, and I want to, because I love God. Because of what? His love for me. Man, we might be here all day at this rate. I'm just going to keep going. You guys good with that? No, just kidding. Some of y'all just freaked out. But obedience is the result of one who understands the gospel. That I will worship God with my life. Again, there's like a bumper sticker, right, that says that he died for me, I'll live for him. Right? It's that simple. Well, maybe it's not that simple, but it's that simple to say. But it's this idea that I will worship God with my life because I understand the gospel. I understand the good news of Jesus and what he has done for me. And as a result, I'm going to take that seriously, that I am now a disciple, which I enter upon into this process of once I receive Christ, I'm now saved, right? I'm a disciple. And then my desire is to make disciples. This is the process. This is the New Testament. This is the whole of it. This is the crux. We'll kind of sum it up towards the end here. But this is it. I will worship God with my life. And part of that is going to be pouring into other people, is going to be a part of a community of brothers and sisters in Christ, and taking that part seriously, and doing life with my brothers and sisters in Christ. And as the body of Christ, as brothers and sisters, we are encouraged throughout the text to exhort one another and encourage one another. We're to hold one another accountable to the things of God, and we're to share the truth in love. And so as we're in proximity with one another and we're starting to hash out some of the hard things together, right? We want to share this truth in love, trusting God, because we know that God is the one who makes up the difference, right? He's the one who creates the heart change. He's the one that creates the life change, not you and I. But he may use us in such a way to draw something out so that life change happens. So when we're walking with our brothers and sisters in Christ, and we notice things that may be off, we should be able to go to them and talk to them about it in a loving manner, one that seeks to restore and build up, and have some hard conversations so that we all grow together. I'm jumping a little bit of ahead here, but we should also be okay when people come to us and say, hey, I see some blind spots, or hey, something's going on in your world, let's talk about it, and be okay with that, and doing this together. But I'm constantly reminded when I'm talking to people and I'm walking through, let's say someone's messed up and you're having this conversation, I'm constantly reminded of one thing that keeps me humble in the conversation, and that's my need for Jesus. That if we're having this discipleship relationship and we're doing this together, may I never forget my desperate need for Christ, so that when I'm talking to people about hard things, I'm reminded that I need Jesus, and that'll help me in that conversation as I talk to someone about their need for Jesus, either in evangelism or in a discipleship relationship. So please don't ever forget that you need Christ every second of every day. The third point: love tells the truth. Discipleship requires love. That was kind of the segue there. But Galatians 6, 1 and 2 states this. Brothers and sisters, even if a person is caught in any wrongdoing, you who are spiritual are to restore such a person in a spirit of gentleness, each one looking to yourself so that you are not tempted as well. Bear one another's burdens and thereby fulfill the law of Christ. Discipleship requires love. Love tells the truth, right? So if I love somebody, I'm going to enter into hard conversations with them because I love them. I have young children. There's one or two parenting methods I could choose. Let them do whatever they want. How's that going to go? Probably not well. Or because I love them, we're going to have some challenging moments, aren't we? We're going to have some hard conversations. Because I love them, I care about them, I want to see them do well. So I'm going to tell them it's not okay to hit your brother in the face with a truck. May or may not be a real example. But because I love them, I'm going to sit down with them and I'm going to have hard conversations. I'm even going to, it's a word we don't like, discipline them. You might have to go into your room for a time. You might have to go into the corner for a time. You might lose that toy because you're not doing what you're supposed to do. And it's not because I want to be the mean dad. No, it's because I love my kids and I want to teach them lessons. I want to walk with them and point them in the direction they need to go. This is discipleship. That's it. Because I love you, because you're my brother or my sister in Christ, I care about you. I want you to know this is happening in your world. Now, I don't go to you and say, you're an awful person. I can't believe you did that. How dare you? And I'm not speaking to you directly, even though I'm pointing at you and looking at you. I don't know you well enough like that. But that's not the way to do it, right? How in tuned are you going to be in responding to me? You're going to be like, that guy's a jerk. And you'd be right, right? That's not how we come at one another. We come at one another in love. Because I love you and care about you, I want to restore you in a spirit of gentleness, as the text stated, right? So that you are able to grow in your walk, in your relationship with Christ. And if I've done it well, you and I are going to grow in our relationship together, because you're going to see, hey, you actually care about me. Now, I'm from Massachusetts, I'm Italian, and I was a born sinner. So I have three strikes kind of right out the gate, right? And so sometimes I've had to learn that my methodology isn't always the right methodology because of those things. Us Italians are pretty blunt, right? If you've ever been in Massachusetts, we're pretty blunt, and generally sin is blinding, right? So I've had to learn this the hard way, that that's not how you talk to somebody, because it doesn't always work for everyone, right? But at the same time, it can't prevent me from not having these conversations. I just had to learn how to have them in love. How to have them in a way that is restoring a brother and sister in Christ. And also how to receive them. Because that can be really challenging when someone's coming up to you and saying you're doing it wrong. Doesn't matter how nicely you say it, you might be like, well, that's just your opinion. That's just your thought. I'm not listening to you. And I'm not going to lie. I have had friends who I've walked with very closely. Well, all of a sudden, I just realized they weren't really talking to me much. And I'm like, what is going on? And they would come back and they'd say, I was a little bit upset with you. And I'd say, okay, why? And they're like, because what you had to say was hard for me to hear. Yeah, I bet it was. And they said, but I know you, and I know that you care about me. And so it just took me some time to process what you're saying. And I'm thankful that you had, we'll call it the guts, to come and tell me the hard thing. Thank you for doing that. And I didn't like it at first, but I'm glad you did it because now I'm growing from it. Right? But what did they do in that instance? A, they heard a hard truth. And again, it doesn't matter how you share it sometimes. Sometimes things are just hard to hear. But they came back to what they knew, and that was they knew me. And they knew my heart was what? For them, not against them. And so once they came to that conclusion, wait, Joe isn't against me. He's for me. I know he's for me because why? He's demonstrated it through our relationship, through proximity. So now I know that he is not out to get me, but he wants what's best for me. Maybe I shouldn't be so upset with Joe, and maybe we can have a conversation about how to get through this thing. Right? Like this happens. It's real. And again, I'm not perfect in it. I'm just giving you examples of things that have happened in my world when I've had to share hard things with people. And I have that pit in my stomach when I'm about to share it. But I trust God and say, look, Lord, help me to just do this right so that I can glorify you, so that this person sees that I love them. This is discipleship. Because not one person in this room has it figured out. I promise you that. We don't. And we need one another. The scripture says what? Iron sharpens iron. I'm gonna throw this out there, and you may not love it, but that requires some friction, right? You ever seen iron getting sharpened and stuff? It's rubbed together. Creates some friction. I'm not that smart. There's some sparks and stuff going on, right? That happens. But guess what also happens? It has to have proximity. Iron has to touch the sharpening thing, right? Like iron has to touch the other iron in order for it to be sharpened. It's not like I could just wave it in the air and it's like, it's sharp. No, it requires those things to come together. It's going to create some friction. There might be some sparks, but if I love you and it's evident that I love you, we can have a real conversation, not get all in our feelings, and maybe grow together. But if we do get in our feelings, may it be evident and true of how we love the individual that they'll come back to, I know you're for me. Let's continue to talk. It's powerful stuff. That requires me to be a disciple, and that requires me as a disciple to have hard conversations with other disciples on both ends. But we're to bear one another's burdens. We're to do life together. We're to take care of one another. And when we have those hard conversations, understanding that we need to be restorative and not condemning, but also keeping in mind that no one likes to be corrected. And Hebrews 12:11 states, for the moment, all discipline seems not to be pleasant, but painful. Yet those who have been trained by it, afterward, it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness. Right, we know that the Lord disciplines those whom he loves. And one of the things that Pastor George, I don't know if you've ever said it here, but it's something that he said to me years ago, man. This, I know he's probably not even going to remember it. Man, this was years ago, but it had a profound effect in my life. This would have been early on, so it must have been maybe 2010. So that's a long time ago, geesh. But he said that we are to learn from grace that which we learn from discipline. That when we don't get what we deserve, that this should be a teaching moment, right? That the Lord disciplines those whom he loves. And that as we get grace, that this is actually a form of discipline in some way, where I'm to learn from that. When I don't get what I deserve, it should drive me to a deeper dependence on Christ, drive me to a deeper thankfulness, drive me to a deeper obedience. Because in all honesty, I deserve death. In all honesty, I deserve the bad thing. But God gave me grace to grow, to learn. And we ought to extend that same grace to one another to grow and to learn. We're not all at the same place in our walk. And something that you might be over, someone else might not be. And you aren't to look at yourself as better than them, but rather you're to get on the same level as them. You're to have the conversation and demonstrate grace to one another so that we can grow together and that we can all get better. Why? Because we want people to see Jesus. And again, it's never easy to hear hard things, but it's always worth it. Proverbs 12:1 states this: "One who loves discipline loves knowledge, but one who hates rebuke is stupid." Yeah, you can laugh. It's okay. I'm not going to lie. I looked like at every translation I could think to look at to see if there was another word for stupid. There's not. I'm pretty sure the text wants us to hear stupid. Like that it's dumb. But think about what's being said. One who loves discipline loves knowledge, right? But one who hates rebuke is stupid. As brothers and sisters in Christ, we should want people in proximity in our life telling us the things that got to go. Talking to us, right? That are actually coming alongside us, being corrected by God's word, right? You open this thing up and it's like, man, this is sharper than any two-edged sword, right? It's able to discern my thoughts and intentions, and nothing is bare before God. And I read this, that's going to convict me, right? That is going to show me the way I live, right? And if I love discipline, I love knowledge, right? And we know that the beginning of wisdom, the beginning of knowledge is the fear of the Lord. Y'all, this isn't just some random thing. This is all very well put together. If you didn't know that, the word of God is very well put together. And if I love God and I have a fear of who he is, right? That's the beginning of wisdom, the beginning of understanding, the beginning of knowledge. Then to hate a rebuke, to hate correction is literally stupid. That's intense. But it's true. And it's where we should want to be. And this is what proximity does. This is what community does. This is what doing life together does. Is it draws these things out so that we get better. And may that be our heart for one another, that we get better. Again, if we're looking at evangelism too and doing life together, that we may be a better representative of Jesus, that they may see it and glorify our Father in heaven. A true loving rebuke requires proximity. It requires relationship. It requires that we do life together. And it can be hard. I'm simplifying the method, but it can be hard. When I first came to Christ and the Lord started moving in my heart into, we'll call it vocational ministry, because I guess I don't know what else to call it. Pastor Brad, who I'm sure George has spoken about here, he was the planting pastor at Cherry Creek Community Church where I actually came to Christ. And he sat me down and he looked me square in the eye. And he said, "Joe, I see God's call in your life, but I want to tell you something very important." And I said, "Oh, this is going to be good. What's that?" And he said, "You're going to pour into people and they're going to vomit all over you." What? "You're going to pour into people and they're going to vomit all over you." And he said this, he said, "You keep your eyes on Jesus and you keep going." And I was like, whoa, what does that mean? Right? Like, help me see that. But this has proven itself incredibly true. That I'm going to spend my life for others. That I'm going to pour into them, and they're just going to make crazy, radical, poor decisions as if we didn't even have a conversation, and they're going to vomit all over me. But I'm to keep my eyes on Jesus, and I'm to keep going. But what was more profound to me was the day that Jesus said this: "Hey, Joe, you're going to do some of the vomiting." What? Think about it. There are going to be people that are going to pour into my life and I'm going to make some radically poor decision and I'm going to vomit all over them. Again, I don't know why the disgusting analogies are happening this morning. I apologize. But that's what this is. And this is why we need to have grace with one another. That we need to do this together. That we leave room for one another's faults, as the text states. So may we strive with one another, all to God's glory, to do this together. I'm getting there. So you guys still tracking with me? You good? I don't know how long Pastor George usually preaches for, so I'm trying to find some happy medium. But I want to put it all together and see. I got another half hour? Oh, in that case, I'm going to back up here. I've been going quick. I don't know. But I want to put it all together and see why being and making disciples is so very important. The next point is our obedience is not only worship, it is testimony. And again, I've alluded to this throughout the whole of it, but I want us to see it. If you have a copy of your scripture, you can turn to the book of Acts. Popular passage, but it's Acts chapter 2. And we're going to look at verses 42 through 47. I spend a lot of time in this text, and I won't kid you, I've preached on it a lot because I think it's so important for us to see. But our obedience is not only worship, it is testimony. In Acts chapter 2, starting in verse 42, it says, they were continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone kept feeling a sense of awe, and many wonders and signs were taking place through the apostles. And all those who had believed were together and had all things in common. And they began selling their property and possessions, and they were sharing them with all as anyone might have need. Day by day, continuing with one mind in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they were taking their meals together with gladness and sincerity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord was adding to their number day by day those who were being saved. Y'all, Christianity is contagious when it is genuinely lived out. That's the next point there. Is Christianity is contagious when genuinely lived out. Now, we know we're going to face rejection. We know we will be hated. We know it may cost us our life. But when we are genuinely living for Christ in community together, taking care of one another, doing the things that God has called us to do. In this instance, they're selling property. They're giving stuff away. They're sharing with one another, making sure that the needs are being met. And it says that they had favor with the people and that the Lord was adding to their number daily those who were saved. When the word of God says that they were saved, there's no question. Were they actually saved? I mean, do we know they did it right? Or they No, they're saved. And the Lord was adding to their number daily. And why? Because people were seeing something radical before them. They were seeing something happen that they had not seen before. They are like, wait a minute, you guys are loving one another in a way that I have not seen. What gives? Because when we start doing this life together and we start living for Christ and people start to see it, what are they genuinely going to have? Questions. And Peter would tell us that we're to have a defense, right, for the hope that is in us, that we're to be able to explain what's going on. So when those people came over and they said, man, I've never seen anything like this. That dude just sold his house so that this family could eat. What is going on here? You think they were like, yeah, we don't know. Have fun. No, they preached the gospel. They said this is because of the work of Christ. That it's not about us doing all these things. It's because we love one another, because the love Christ has for us is so compelling that we can't help but love other people. We want to take care of one another. We have the same mind. We're devoted to these guys over here. They're teaching. We're devoted to that. We're devoted to breaking bread together. We want to do life together so that other people may come to know Jesus. That our obedience is not only worship, it is testimony. This is so important. And that's why I'm saying when we take discipleship and evangelism, we can reduce it down to the phrase of do life together. Because when we do this well, when we love well, people can't help but take notice. This isn't humanitarian acts, man. This is literally taking it serious. You have a need. I'm going to do whatever I can to help fill that need. Right? We're gonna go ahead, and if you're sick, we're going to find a way to take care of you. We're going to do whatever we can. We're going to make some decisions that the world might say, that is goofy. I don't get it. Why would you give that person $1,000? Well, they needed it. Well, they could be manipulating you and you just gave them $1,000. That's on them. I was led to do it, and I'm going to love them in a radical way in hopes that they see Christ. And if they are manipulative and they've played me, okay, I don't have to deal with that part. That's not Joe, right? I did what God led me to do, right? And then when we take care of one another in such a way, man, that people would see and not glorify us, but glorify our Father in heaven. And the way that happens is we point to him. That's all we are. We're beacons, right? Would you agree? Like, that's what we are. Jesus says, you're the light of the world. Like, you're the beacons. You're out here being a beacon. And how do we do that? We shine much brighter together than we do alone, right? It's hard to ignore a group of people living radically for Jesus. That is a hard thing to ignore. It's tough because people can't help but see something different. And I contend that we live in some really interesting times. I don't think they're any more interesting than other times. I just think we live in interesting times. And we've been brought here at this time, all of us, every single one of us collectively, to live in such a way that points to Jesus. And right now, things can feel pretty dark. I don't know, you watch the news, you feel like everything's going to end tomorrow. And Maranatha, right? But here's the deal. While I'm here, what am I doing? What am I doing with my life? Because I believe personally, this is Joe's conjecture based on the text, that I am here to bring glory to Jesus, period. That whether I eat or drink or whatever I do, I'm here to bring glory to God. And as a result, I hope people join me in that journey. And I don't have it all figured out, so I need y'all to join me on the journey because I need people telling me I'm doing things wrong. And I welcome it. But are we living in such a way? Let's personalize it. Are y'all in Plainwell, in this church, as this congregation, are you living in such a way that this community sees Jesus? I asked my church this question probably a couple months ago. I said, if we disappeared, would the community know? Would they feel it? That's a profound question. But I would like to say, yeah, I think they would feel it. But when we all looked at each other as a congregation, there's 140 of us sat down together, we kind of looked at each other like, I don't know that they would know. They might just drive by the building and say, oh, there's no one using that building anymore. And that that breaks me. Because our challenge, if you will, is not to just come here on Sunday to check our box. It's to grow in the things that Christ has called us to grow in so that we make an impact in the communities that we've been placed in. And so it's the same challenge to y'all as it is to Cherry Creek. If you disappeared tomorrow, would this community know that you disappeared? And I'm not saying, you know, put out big signs so that if they were gone, the signs were down. Like, oh, well, those big signs are gone. No, I mean like with your life, right? That if you're breathing and you're here, you still have a mission, you still have a call that you are on, and you are together as a body, whether there be 10 of you or 400 of you, to make an impact in the community that you have been placed in, and you do that by genuinely loving others. Man, may that be true of our churches. This isn't a social club, as much as we want to make it one. It's not. It is about us growing together to reach people for Christ. That our obedience is not only worship, but it is testimony. Because the way we live matters, because there are lives at stake. I mean, if you've been here when I've preached before, you've probably heard me say this 100 times. Because it's true. The way we live matters because there are lives at stake. There are people that are dying that do not know Jesus. And we have been given a responsibility. We have been given a call. Now, Jesus saves, but he has called us to go. And we'll finish there. You probably already know that. The way we live matters because there are lives at stake. There are people that you know that you are connected to that do not know Jesus. How are you changing that? What are you doing to point them to Christ? Are you having the hard conversation, right? Because again, well, man, if I share Jesus with them, they might not want to hang out. Okay, that's true. That's possible. But they might just be waiting for somebody to talk to them about it. We just recently lost my mother-in-law a couple weeks ago, and it was heavy. But my wife sat down and had that conversation with her mom. And I know it was hard. And I know my wife overthought every single second of that conversation, wondering, did I do it right? And I said, well, what did your mom say? She said that she believed that Jesus is Lord. And I said, then that's enough. that that's good, that praise God, let's rest in that. And then we can rest. And I said, look, babe, I believe that God is faithful. And you sat down and you had a hard conversation with your mom. Not everyone gets the deathbed conversation. And you got to sit down and you got to talk to her about Jesus. And you prayed with her. And she said that she believes that Jesus is Lord, that she sought forgiveness. Like, let's roll with that. I'm going to let God be God in that scenario. And I'm going to trust because you had that conversation, that you took that time, and that she responded in the way she did, that she has entered the kingdom of God upon her death. And I praise God for that. But my wife could have said, well, I don't want to create a problem. I don't want my mom to get upset because she could get upset if I bring up Jesus. And I don't want her to be upset about that. I mean, she's dying, right? This is the most important time. My wife didn't have that question. She just said, I'm gonna go in. And if my mom gets upset, she gets upset. But I'm going to talk to her about Jesus. That's where we need to be, man. Because people are dying. People in your proximity, in your circle. There are people that you're going to connect with that I'll never connect with. And vice versa. And you have a call to point them to Christ. Trusting that he makes up the difference, that he is the Savior, that you are not, but you are a beacon, that you are a person who is to share the gospel with them. And if we understand the gospel, if we understand that we've been brought from death to life, if we understand that we have been made new, this is motivation, right? This is the drive. This is why they tell you, like, you can never hear the gospel too many times. I'm constantly reminded, and I love that, of what Christ has done for me. Because it is motivation. It is a drive. I need to hear it continuously to remind myself, hey, just keep going. Yeah, the world's vomiting all over me right now, but that's okay. I'm going to keep my eyes on Christ, and I'm going to keep going. Because I understand the gospel. And I want to meet people where they're at. And I want to love on them. So that they come to know Jesus. Or if they do know Christ, I want to be a blessing. I want to minister to them so that they grow in Christ. So that they may impact people that I'll never meet. That's really genuinely my heart in all of that. And you're going to, like I said, you're going to connect with people that I'll never connect with. That I'll never be able to meet. And vice versa. But knowing that we're in this together, that should strengthen us. That, like, hey, I don't have to reach everyone. I just have to go out and reach someone, whoever's in my circle, whatever it is. I don't have to save the world, right? I just have to talk to people that I'm around. Family, friends, whoever God puts in my path, and represent Christ to them. And if I don't know something, I can go to a brother or sister and learn. Don't just fall on Google and say, Google, how do I do this? Or what is this? Go to a friend and say, hey, I really want to share Jesus with so-and-so. I'm struggling. Can we talk it through? Sweet. Let's have that conversation. So in closing, I'm going to read what will likely be a very familiar passage to you. It's not some cute saying of Jesus, but this is actually a command and one that we ought be doing. And we would know it as the Great Commission, right? You probably saw it all ending and culminating in this thing. But one of the things that I think we forget is that this Great Commission, this is a command. This is not just something that we can skirt over. This is something we ought to take seriously until the time we are with our Lord. And Jesus said this in Matthew 28:18-20. And Jesus came up and spoke to them, saying, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to follow all that I commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. As individuals who are submitted to God's authority, those who proclaim the name of Jesus, we are to go. We have been given a mission. And if you pause and if you really think about it, we have been brought into the greatest mission of all time, the redemptive plan that the Lord has. And that is by his grace that he has brought us into this process. that this mission should excite us, that the Creator of everything has called us into His redemptive work and made us a part of it. I mean, this should get us going a bit, right? This is exciting, right? You want to live a life that matters, and Jesus is like, I got you. This is a life that matters. You are on mission, and it's a sweet mission. It's a powerful mission. It's one that has eternal ramifications. And I love how Jesus ends this. When he says, you know, I am with you always, even to the end of the age, that the one who has called us to go, goes with us. That's beautiful. I don't have to rest on my own strength, right? That I have the Spirit of God who dwells in me, that where I go, He goes. That's beautiful. That Jesus says, go, but He's like, but I'll be there. You're not doing this on your own. You're not doing this on your own strength. This isn't of you. You just live submitted to me and my authority, and you go out and you teach, right? We see this in the text. Unless I'm reading it wrong, that's what I see, and that's what I see as our mission. And we do that all through a very worshipful obedience that speaks boldly of who Jesus is, so that others may come to know Him. And then when they do, we start teaching them all that Jesus has taught. This is the process, right? You go out, you preach the gospel, they come to Christ, you plug them into a church, you get them discipled, you start walking with them, you're doing life so that they can go and make disciples. That's the process. If you want a formulaic checklist, it's right there. Okay? Preach the gospel, walk alongside them, equip and train them up to go and preach the gospel. That's it. So again, for me, I'm thankful that people took this call seriously, that I would not be who I am today, that I would not be where I am today, if not by the grace of God. And for people who loved Jesus and poured that love out onto me and taught me how to go and do the same, I praise God for that. I really, really genuinely pray that you have people in your life that love you that way, and that you're one of those people that love others that way. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, first and foremost, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for the love that you have for us. Father, I do praise you for this place, Lord, where we can come and we can dig into your word, where we can sing your praises, where we can pray openly, where we can discuss the things that you have for us. Lord, help us not to squander this. Help us not to just cheapen it, Lord, but to realize and see what we have here. Father, currently we live in a nation where we can freely proclaim your name. Lord, help us not to squander this gift, but help us to walk in truth. Help us to love one another and to boldly proclaim your name, that we may be lights in an ever-present darkness. Father, help us. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your Spirit, and we thank you for one another. We thank you that you have called us into such an amazing plan, that we have an incredible mission that you have given us, and that you have equipped us in every way, and that you yourself go with us. Father, I pray that each one here just start to pray about who you may have them impact, who they need to invite in, both from a discipleship perspective and an evangelistic perspective, Father. Just place names in their head. Make it so evident and so clear. And then help each and every one of us, Lord, to take action, to not be complacent, to not walk in fear, but that you have given us a spirit of boldness, that we may be bold. And we thank you and we praise you for all that you've done, all that you will do, and all that you are currently doing. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.